Sonic Talk.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Sonic Talk, episode 587. I do apologise for not having a show last week, but as I was saying in the preamble of the show, if you watch us live, because we live stream generally from around half past three, there's usually a bit of preamble beforehand. I was mentioning in the show that literally there was very little news and everybody was out of action and working and stuff, so there was just there wasn't anything to make a show with, so I do apologise, but that's just the way it goes next week. And I feel rather embarrassed to say that there will be no show next week, but that's because we're in London for a product launch, so we'll be back with good tidings, I hope, for all of you synth lovers. I'm not saying anything more, but in its place I do have an interview that I shot with Imogen Heap, which is about 40 minutes. Which hopefully you'll just great. She's a great one for talking as well. You wouldn't have any trouble filling hours of time with her, because she's just sort of very energetic and full of things to say. So you can look out for that next week, because that will be placed in place of an actual live show, because we'll be in London and unable to do the show, but we should be back the week after. So that's all I can say for the moment. But yes, welcome. This is the podcast to do with music technology, synthesizers, industry stuff, software, controllers, all kinds of things, basically. So if you're interested in that sort of stuff, stay tuned, and we'll be talking about that over the next hour or so with my guest, Gaz Williams, who I'll introduce in a second. And also, we've got a competition for, if you want to win a copy of Isotope's Neutron 3, which is a fantastic sort of modern mixing tool. You put a plug-in across all of your tracks, or as many of your tracks if you want, and it can talk to itself and figure out what frequencies are overlapping stuff. Really fascinating. So that's an advanced version of that, which is up for grabs. Competition will be about halfway through. So anyway, I want to say hello to my first and only guest, Gaz. Yes. Williams, who's there in Bristol. Hello. Gaz, bass player, music technologist, amongst many other things. How are you, Gaz? You well?
Yeah, good, thank you. Glad to be here. There is a bit of a dearth of news, isn't there, this time of year, typically. So, but that doesn't mean that there's not loads to talk about.
There's no dearth of words.
No dearth of words.
Exactly. Well, yeah. There is news, but some of it's kind of quite sort of similar. I mean, it's more general discussion stuff, which is maybe things that we've talked about before. So, you know, one has to balance these things. We don't want to talk about the same things every week. We try not to anyway, but sometimes you just can't help it when when that's all there is. So maybe that's the best. So what have you been up to then, Gaz?
Just come back from Green Man Festival. I was meant to be playing there, but actually ended up not playing, which was a bit of a weird thing, but that was okay, because I had a really good time there. And something I noticed at Green Man Festival is one of the big festivals on the UK festival circuit, very much along the lines of Six Music, BBC Six Music, the radio station there. So lots of acts that you'd typically find on that station. It's ostensibly a folk centered festival, but not really a folk festival, more of a modern folk. I don't know. I don't quite know how to define it, really. But something really occurred to me at this festival, and it was following on from a video that I'd seen on YouTube about the death of melody. I can't remember the name of the guy who's posted that video, but it's been a very popular video, which is talking about how melody is really is kind of out of fashion. And you think, how can melody be out of fashion? And the guy puts forward a very convincing case for it. I wish I could remember. Maybe someone in the chat.
Melody Inside the Score, it looks like.
That's Inside the Score. Thank you very much.
He's got a very interesting poster frame, which looks like... let's have a look, see if we can find it. I'm trying to find the poster frame, because it looks like a very sort of... I can't see it
for
now.
A promo code.
Looks like we're got.
Yeah.
Oh, this is Honey, an advert for Honey, not an advert for Grammarly, which makes a change on YouTube. Let's see if I can find it. So
this channel has always focused death on film melody. Music and classical music. That's always been my goal. But
I haven't watched that, so I'm at your mercy. You'll have to pricey it for us.
Okay, I mean, you know, he talks about pop music, but he also talks about sort of how melody is kind of, you know, how soundtracks have moved away from melodies and some classical music as well, some modern contemporary classical music, focusing on other aspects. He's talking about sort of tone, you know, like tone, texture and...
atmosphere and mood.
Yeah. But also within pop music, and he uses some examples where, you know, the melody is mostly just on a single note with just maybe very, very slight melodic variations of maybe one or two notes. And that kind of hooks don't necessarily need to be melodic. They could have, the hook could be even just like the lyric repeated in a single note, you know, just repeated single notes. And I thought it was a really interesting, you know, well put together video. I'd recommend watching it. It's good. So I went to Green Man Festival, which, as I was mentioning, is, you know, like a... I nearly said ostensibly then, but I've been pulled out.
I didn't want to say that word. Your ostensibly count is actually two for the show so far.
Yes, so I've used up all my ostensiblys. but yeah, so Green Man, you know, has this, what would be very typically very melodic music at the festival, but... virtually all the acts I saw did not rely on melody at all. I mean, the examples, I saw the band Idols on the Sunday night, which are a Bristol punk band who give an incredibly entertaining, high energy show with pretty much everything going on other than melody. Then I saw a couple of young bands who were really promising, a band called Squid and another band called Black Country New Road, both really great bands, but kind of like with sort of shouted vocals with no discernible melodies within it at all. And then a couple of fantastic British, kind of from the British jazz scene, both featuring the saxophone player Shabaka Hutchins. The Comet Is Coming and Sons of Kemet, both of which don't really deal in specifically melodies, although there's lots and lots of notes going on.
I wonder why that is, though, Gaz. I mean, do you think... sorry to butt in, but I have a theory about this. I mean, I think partly it's because certainly probably composers in for picture are probably a bit sick of having their soundtracks turned down. You know, so essentially if you have a melody trying to break through, the dialogue will trump it, or the sound effects might trump it in most instances. So the opportunities to play a melody would only really be maybe at the beginning and the end, or there might be a theme point where you have it. But I mean, so that might be one thing. So people, well, why bother? Because it'll just get crushed. And the other thing is, there are, as we know, you know, it's harder to... a lot of music is an incidental byproduct to doing something else rather than sitting down and listening to it. So maybe those are the sort of, those are two factors.
Yes, I'm sure. But it was just interesting though, seeing that these different bands were all, you know, as I say, using other devices other than actually relying on melody particularly. You know, and these bands were great. You know, it wasn't that they were bad in any way. Although I do kind of leave those gigs with a little bit of an empty feeling that there's not much to take away from in terms of songs that you'll that particularly stand out. And I think that melodies are the things that do... are the thing that sticks with you, aren't they, really?
Well, they're hard. They're hard things to it's a hard thing to do well. Although, I mean, yeah, you also bear in mind, you know, I mean, with pop music and sort of club music and those things, I mean, you tend to get a melody and it's just repeated and repeated and repeated and not generally evolves much. But I don't see a problem with that, because there's some very, very catchy stuff, you know. I mean, that's part of the thing that helps it get remembered, I suppose.
Yeah, absolutely. I think maybe it is a bit of a taste thing. I do really love a very long melody, though, like a melody that might take, you know, more than 16 bars, maybe up 32 bars to tell its whole melody. But upon repeated listens, you know, that melody starts to reveal itself. And I really think that the true value in music, though, does kind of hinge on a great melody. Certainly songs, you know, soundtracks is a different world, isn't it, of course. And even dance music, you know, if the purpose of the music is to dance to, then, you know, maybe that sort of more sophisticated approach to melody doesn't necessarily fit into that kind of thing. But still, it was, yeah, I thought it was interesting because it did back up that video, really. But just on one note, though, I have to say, though, that the Comet is coming. We played a gig with them a couple of years ago with Asteroid Deluxe, but seeing the Comet is coming on the far out stage was my highlight. Partly because the keyboard player, his name is Danalog, and he plays...
I
can't be honest, he is maybe now my favourite synth player, current synth player. He plays a Juno, and he plays... Well, he mostly with a Juno, he's mostly, I think, just using it with a sustain pedal, but all the action takes place on a Roland SH-09, of all things. And the guy is astonishing with it. The things he does with it is mind-blowing. And he uses,
I bet they sound good as well, yeah.
They do.
SH09
Yeah. What's that? A single oscillator. Very simple.
Oh yeah, but it's got the beefiest, like the beefiest of beefy oscillators. I mean, it really is. I mean, it's a fantastic. I think it's got a sub oscillator. I think, if I remember correctly, but it's massively weighty.
But what, he really shines with this thing, though, is that he can play it almost like a guitarist would, sort of like a guitarist could contort and whammy bar and do all this kind of stuff. He's like using all the controls in ways, in a very sort of performative way, you know, like using octave switching, sort of performant, but also various other kind of parameters. And not just simply doing kind of
not the filter.
And I think he had it going into a little Boss DD something, little, you know, single stomp box. And I think this is a big part of why they sound good, is he's got it going into an Ampeg SVT with an 8x10 cab.
Jesus.
And big valve. And he's really hitting that quite hard as well. So it's got quite a dirty sound to it.
And presumably not too piercing, because that's going to cut down. Is that just the SH09 that goes into the bass amp, or is it the Juno as well? Because the Juno would be stereo, wouldn't it, I think?
Yeah, I couldn't tell, to be honest. But I mean, because as I say, most of the stuff that he does is just on this monosynth. And that really kind of interested me, just in how he was using the monosynth in this such a creative way. So it's just a three-piece band. There's a drummer and there's a guy, Shabaka, fantastic saxophone player. Shabaka has this particular style where he's always pushing the beat up. The music is just so, I mean, it's just this three piece.
The reason that came up is just, I'm trying to find a video clip just so we've got some sort of concept.
But you know, he did this little solo piece on the monosynth. And
here we go.
Honestly, I've never heard anyone do anything like it. That's them. That's Danalog. There's Shabaka. Yeah.
Did he used to be in the 1976 or something as well? Or Soccer? Because I've seen somebody else with a Juno.
Yes, Soccer. That's him. It's Soccer.
There we go.
Yes. I can't remember the title. Yes, it was. That I think.
Soccer something at 60. Oh, here we go.
Come on,
that's
bring it
very
on.
Free, isn't it? Yeah, I like the sound of that. That's going to be. I bet that's great to see live, perhaps more than recorded, though. Yeah.
Oh no, it sounds great on recording as well. Their records are fantastic. I think their first album was Mercury Prize nominated. It does make for a great listen as well. But like, yeah, out through a massive rig at a festival where it's really banging. It's just, oh man, I was literally floored by that show. It was amazing.
Excellent.
And prior to that, my previous highlight was I'd just seen Stereolab, which was a 25-year ambition of mine. I've loved them for such a long time. I'd never seen them live. And that was great, too. Because, of course, Stereolab were using all sorts of interesting vintage synthesizers and keyboards and organs and things, weren't they? That was a big part of their sound. They were really modeled on that French futurist pop sort of sound.
Are they Welsh, Stereolab?
No. No. There's it's a French, British, English kind of the singer Letitia Sadler is French, and Tim, what's his name? He's the guitarist, main guy, he's English guy. But they Very unique sound, Stereolab. But as I say, they were using lots of vintage synths and things which were really out of fashion. Things like in the early 90s, string synths and stuff like that, which really...
Were they part of the Philips Philacordia revival? That sounds quite possible. I'm just about to bring this up. This is them as well. Let's have a look. What's he got there? OB6. That looks like a reface and a rose.
I think quite soon. Yeah. And
Right, hold on a sec. I have to turn it off. Gosh, that was a bit epic. Yeah, sorry about that.
Fantastic, though. So, for live, they're using kind of reliable modern stuff. But their studio recordings were typically, you know, full of vintage instruments of, you know, some really interesting stuff there. But it's quite interesting because they were pursuing a particular thing that was just completely, you know, on its own, really, in terms of not belonging to any movement or scene particularly, you know, lots of elements of krautrock and various other things. But I particularly loved it at the gig, though, because I just felt it was like, I don't know, like, and I mean this in a completely clean way, adult entertainment.
Sophisticated
modern with a great texture and brilliant, really, really great. So, it was my two highlights, but the Comet is coming. I honestly, you've got to see them. Oh, no, there is one more I'd like to mention, though. So Shabaka plays in this other band called the Sons of Kemet, which, again, very peculiar lineup. They were one saxophone, two drummers, and a tuba player. So the tuba player, I wish I could remember his name. He was doing, like, all the kind of handling all the bass end stuff, but one incredible tuba player. He'd be dancing the whole gig as well and doing all this, again, a bit like Shabaka, a lot of that, bop, 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 you know, really kind of sort of staccato fast lines on a tuba.
Was he playing it into Trace Elliott?
I don't know. But one thing that happened that I thought was really funny, though, at one point during the gig, everybody else left the stage except for the tuba player, who just did this like 5-minute amazing tuba solo. And it was a capacity crowd. It was on the main stage, loads of people there. And I was thinking to myself, I bet that right now this is the biggest audience for a solo tuba in the world.
And probably not only right now, I'd imagine pretty much since their last gig.
But again, just he was using that tuba in ways I just couldn't even fathom. Just incredible, really. So again, another band really well worth checking out. Just totally redefining what you'd expect from a band, I suppose. You know, the lineup being
The instrumentation just being unusual, something that you've not seen before. So that's
But,
right, that's interesting. Yeah. Oh, excellent. Well, I didn't make it to any. I was painting this weekend, pretty much. Painting a ceiling, which is, if I've got any paint on the top of my head that I haven't spotted, that's probably why. A couple of ceilings. Yeah, well, I'm glad it was good. And the other thing that happened this weekend, there was just sort of really awful weather. So you managed to escape that, fortunately, just one day of terrible torrential rain. That's good. Yeah. I'm glad to hear that. okay, well, let's get on. I was going to play this last show, but I didn't get the opportunity, so I'm going to I think it's this one, so check this out. And what I really like about this is it's just a noise synth, but he's using it as the soundtrack to, this is obviously Titanic, which I'm sure we get busted for. But I just thought I've never seen a synth I've never seen one used like this. I've never considered for that sort of sound effects, kind of really. And it is quite. It sounds like a dying ocean liner at the moment.
Isn't it processing? My Heart Will Go On.
I don't know if it is or not. I think they just put that in. I watched it for ages. The low end and the stuff is astonishing. Let me see if I can find. This was actually the what was it? XL3 Shard, which is a sort of noise synth that I can't quite figure out whether it's a DIY or you've just got opportunities to modify it yourself. But it's just quite an interesting concept, and it's like £300, so it's quite specialised. But it's just that I, because I never really figured out the whole, you know, the noise synth doesn't really, I mean, although to be fair, I suppose I have got a Lyra 8, which is fairly noisy, but it's kind of chordally noisy and it can be very beautiful as well. I don't get the sense this was so beautiful, but I'd never really thought of using a synth like that for those kind of things. And it sort of makes quite a lot of sense for this sort of visceral, floor-shaking kind of sound effects generation as well. I just thought, yeah, that's cool.
Yeah. And do we know how much it is? Because it does look...
300 quid. I mean, it's not terribly cheap, but it's specialised, I think, as we say. Boutique and specialised.
Oh, but it is funny, though, when you do delve into just pure noise, you know, and it can have a really sort of magical effect, you know. I mean, it's not always the nicest thing for other people to listen to, but just exploring it and just... but, you know, there is a beauty within noise, though, isn't there? There is something quite...
Sometimes.
You know, sometimes.
I think if there is some, at least some harmonic intervals that make a certain amount of sense, it can work like that. I don't know. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. I mean, you were talking about this kind of more evolving melody, and I do remember Joe Zawinul, very, very famously, some of his stuff, later Weather Report stuff and solo stuff, he would create these amazing lines and chord lines which had the like really bizarre harmonic intervals and almost really atonal stuff. But it sort of became, as your ear tuned into it and the other stuff was fitted around it, it really started to make sense. Whereas on its own, it can be a bit grating, but he was very good at that. I wish I could think of some examples, but I suppose there are times when it can work, but that's the only one I could think of.
Well, I suppose talking about like melody, you know, part of the thing about melody is it has like a narrative to it, you know, like a melody. And so you could with, you know, with noise, if you are shaping the noise with some sense of narrative, if that makes kind of sense.
Like to picture, you know, it's probably easier to do to picture than it is to just something else.
It gives it some context, doesn't it? But yeah, I do. I've been enjoying the Electron Analog Heat and really, you know, with it on its kind of nastiest sort of settings. I think a big part of noise, though, is the filtering, isn't it? You know, filtering the noise, and sort of maybe that is as much a part of the... you know, you can pluck out the
harmonics and filter it down.
So I suppose the filter can make extract music out of the noise, I suppose, you know. Yeah, with a bit of resonance and but yeah, I mean, you know, we've talked about this a number of times, really, how just sometimes just making noise just for the sake of noise, not for any other purpose other than just the therapy of noise manipulation.
It's like sort of chopping wood or digging a hole or running up a hill or something. It's got the same sort of therapeutic qualities, right?
Yeah, definitely. Here's a question. Pink or white noise? What would be your choice?
I suppose for flexibility, I'd probably go for white because I could always filter it, whereas pink is more fully... It's like an EQ curve. I do remember we had a discussion about this in the past because there are so many different. There's brown, pink, blue, purple. In fact, doesn't the Matrix Brute have several different flavors of noise? It's got all these unusual flavors. It's like 3 or 4, I think it is. I can't remember now, and they all have a very different quality. And that sort of works. I mean, I suppose that makes sense. And I remember when we did. We did a piece with Alessandro Cortini when we went to his place after NAMM, and he showed us this beautiful. It works very well on those tuned filter, those fixed filter banks, and he was creating these amazing sort of. They were like eraser head background noises, which I suppose is similar to what we just heard there, but a bit more finessed. And they were just by using these filter banks by really picking out these high Q harmonics from just a straight noise, and it can almost sound vowel like and you get the sense that there is a shape. Certainly in Eraserhead, you got the sense that there were pipes of different dimensions with things going through them that those harmonics suggested, and it really made for a very strong atmosphere. Because it's been a very long time since I've seen Eraserhead. It's of course David Lynch is one of David Lynch's early art films.
Yeah,
but it's got there's lots of stark rooms with pipes running through them, and I think that's hence the way that worked. I don't know what was used in that. Yeah. I'd be interested to know.
The Dreadbox Abyss has got quite an interesting noise element in it, in that you've got this kind of variable waveform that sort of goes through various like pulse widths to sawtooth over eventually into noise, and then you can modulate that waveform so it'll dip into the noise, and the depth depends on how much into the noise it'll go, and or you can just have it so you just got like a little hint of noise if you want to kind of get like a kind of breathy or sort of some sort of texture. But like when you start playing with the LFO and having it going into the noise, it feels like it's like the danger zone, and you can get it just right and get the rhythm really nice, just sort of dipping into the noise. I think that's a really, really cool way, rather than noise being like a separate element, with it being part of
in introduction, I think we probably discussed noise and randomness in synthesis is something that is a whole area of topics we could probably spend all afternoon talking about. I hold that thought, and we may as well do the let's do our little piece from let's have a word from our friends over at Isotope.
Presenting Neutron 3, the modern way to mix. Bring your workflow into the 21st century with 8 modern mixing tools, all at your fingertips in one mothership plugin. Starting a mix can take a while, but with the all-new Mix Assistant, Neutron can listen to your audio and quickly suggest a custom starting point for an individual track or set levels for your entire mix. Shape sounds like never before with the new Sculptor module. Match audio to a target sonic profile and instantly sculpt it to sound more like itself or like something else completely. Reach out and touch your audio with Neutron's immersive controls and visualizations. Neutron 3 comes equipped with Visual Mixer, a tool to help you effortlessly manipulate the landscape of your mix. Neutron 3, the modern way to mix.
And of course, if you want to try that out, you can head over to isotope.com, sign up for an account, and you get access to, I think it's a free 10-day demo for that. But they are giving away a copy of Neutron 3. And it's advanced, which means I don't know what the difference between advanced and standard is. I think maybe you get a better meter. I'm going to stop there because I probably don't know, and I'll only make it worse. Let's see. So we've got a competition. So we're looking for the hashtag. This is a bit complicated to read out. 21st century mixes. 21 ST, 21st century mixes as one word, and the hashtag Neutron 3 as the other word. So tweet those, because it's a Twitter competition, to @SonicState and @IsotopeInc. So what we do is we pick out we take a random number from the number of entries, and then we count down the number of random number, and then we pick the entry that wins. So it is truly, I wouldn't say it was kind of totally scientific, but it's about as random as we can manage without getting involved in sort of deeper mathematics. But anyway, we wanted to say we have a winner for last week. Last week we've got somebody called, I don't know if I'm going to pronounce this, Daiku1. And they tweeted, not last week, last competition, former software guy that loves fine furniture building. That sounds interesting. Like this product, and of course, Sonic State. So if you want to get in touch at Daiku1, then you are this last week's winner, or last show's winner of Neutron 3. And congratulations. Let's have a look here. One Voice Deckard. What should we go next? I think we'll go. Yeah, let's have a look at that. Did I get this? So this is the news that Black Corporation, who made the Deckard's Dream, and so they've got the a kind of rack version of the CS80 sort of voice machine. Not necessarily the hardware. They're bringing out Deckard's Voice, which is a single CS80 voice. Style voice in Eurorack, and it's only a couple of $100, and they're going to be doing pre-orders at the moment, so I guess they will be ramping up for bigger amount of sales. And they've also got Deckard's Dream pre-order $199, and then there's also the Rachel, because a lot of people were saying that let me see if I've got to open this one as well, because I didn't have this window ready. A lot of people were saying that it's nothing without the without the ring mod, and there's very little actually information about the module Rachel, which is the Vangelis inspired modulator. Mm-hmm. But it's interesting, isn't it? How and we talked about this before, how the thought of having something so of the largesse of a CS80, this kind of legendarily unaffordable synthesizer that's also actually kind of hard to own just purely because it's so finickety. The thought of that, the brand of it is so strong that people will buy bits of it, even though the bit of it has sort of almost nothing to do with the physical nature of the actual instrument itself, like the poly aftertouch, the physicality of the keyboard and the touch strip and all of those things. It's interesting. I think it'll do well, despite the fact that it's not actually, the CS80.
It's also funny how, the impact of Blade Runner as a cultural icon can give this Deckard's Dream, and now it's called Rachel. I can't think of any other maybe film that has quite such a I don't think so. In the synth world that holds just such a strong appeal that you could name modules after it. But it looks good, doesn't it? I think all of the Black Corporation stuff is has a lot of intrigue about
cachet
it.
What's the thing? I got that totally wrong. 199 is the deposit for Deckard's voice. The actual full thing is 699. So you pay 199 now, and then presumably you put the 399 on the delivery. So I do beg your pardon. Before you rush out and max out your credit card, it's not 199, it's 699. I do beg your pardon.
Wow, 699. How much is the Deckard's Dream though? And that's 8 voices.
About
isn't it,
$4,000, something like that. Let's have a look.
I suppose when you start adding it all up. With a Deckard's Dream though, because I haven't actually had a go of one. How much of the CS80 is in that then of the Deckard Stream? Or, because we're talking about like the oscillators and the filters and the ring mod. And as you mentioned.
That's a good question. Using Technology Today, and in the near future, you'll be able to play Deckard Stream with a stunning expressive control. It's Kimji. Yeah. Oh, gosh. That's a good question. 16 VCOs, polyphonic aftertouch, and I've switched to this.
Okay. It's got the poly aftertouch then.
Analog and DSP effects built in as well. Video reviews. The Kimji review, the synth I've been reviewing. Oh, I wonder who got to review that.
Ricky Tino.
Ricky Tino, okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, he's been making some good video content, I think.
Oh no, that's something else. That's the Kimji, which is the that's the Kimji, which is the RSF Cobol, which is a really interesting synth as well. Actually, I remember. I'm trying to think who it was now. They did a fantastic emulation of it, Poly Cobol, and I'm trying to remember who it was. The thing that was really good about it was the morphing between the waveforms was just astonishing. What's it called? Cobol, Poly Cobol. Gosh, my memory's. It was years ago. I did software Poly Cobol. Who was it? Zills Lab. That's right, Zills Lab.
Zills Lab.
That was a great. And I remember for the time that was an amazing sounding synth in software. Mm-hmm. It was one of those synths that kind of raised the bar for other software synths to try and incorporate. So it was one of those things that helped increase the quality of general quality of those synths. Anyway, I'm sorry. I'm tangentializing here. At least it's on the synth subject, I suppose.
Yeah, no, it's good. They're based, I think, are they based in Tokyo, Black Corporation?
I think they might be, might be.
I think there's a couple of American guys in the company as well, but I think they are based, I think they're based in Tokyo, and they like to party, that's for sure.
Well, that's interesting, because we are going to Tokyo quite soon, so maybe we'll get a chance to meet them. That would be interesting.
That's not a bad idea. Yeah.
Yeah. Although I would like some time off. I mean, Okay. Right. Mm. So anyway, that's the one voice Deckard, which is Deckard's voice, and the Rachel, which will be coming along at some time in the soon history of it. So let's have a look. Should we do this? Should we do? Did you see the? I'm trying to look for it. This was a video that was recently posted from Continue Con. And this was Geert Beaven talking about the history of alternative controllers. And he's got the Eigenlab stuff there. He's got a Pico and the Eigenharp. Is that the Alpha? There was another one which is even bigger. And he just sort of talks about the whole way that it's become... it's evolved, you know, this kind of polyphonic expression, obviously the instrument, and he's a really big exponent of that kind of stuff. I mean, without him, I think MPE probably wouldn't have got as far as it had. Interesting watch.
No,
I mean,
definitely. And Geert's now a full-time employee of Moog Music now, which I think is a smart move, because he's been on the show, hasn't he? He's a super, super nice and super smart guy. And it's interesting because he was an early proponent of the Eigenharp, which, you know, I was remembering back about that, the idea of the Eigenharp when it first came out. Because, you know, it's like, it's got all these keys which are, which can do, you know, up and down, left and right, and pressure. And very, very, very sensitive to the touch too. So in many ways, it was a forerunner, really, I guess, to things like the Linstrument and the Seaboard, although albeit in a very different format. But one of the things about the Eigenharp, though, gosh, which must have been really, really hard for people to do, is you could build synth voices on the fly. You could kind of create an envelope, but you'd have to learn strange.
Yeah, it was I had the Pico to review, and it was one of those things that every time you touched it, it just went completely haywire, because they didn't they didn't do any rounding on the parameters, and you couldn't adjust the sensitivity very well, and they just weren't. Yeah, it was very difficult.
It was a shame. I had a Pico too, but it was just really hard to make music on it. Although, you know, that had like the touch strip on there, and it also had the pipes, so you could do breath control, and or you could do bowing with the with this like kind of touch strip, and I could get some quite nice kind of cello kind of action on it, but it was just ultimately just a little bit too hard to play. And however, you know, this is how I first became aware of Geert, and then sort of following him from there on. And, you know, he was the guy who I think he wrote the firmware for the Linstrument. So he's heavily involved with Roger Lynn on the Linstrument. And then, so he, I guess, is probably the most qualified person to talk on this matter, I suppose. That's a good feature to watch, though, because he goes into quite deep, good detail about
what's really interesting about this, though, is because the Alpha Labs, the Eigenlabs, they went early, and I remember going to Music Messer, and in many ways there were similar parallels between them and Roly, because they got the guy, I forget the story, there was a backstory behind it, the guy basically sold a company for millions, and this was just something he wanted to do, so he hired lots of bright young things, and literally we went to Music Messer, and he had his booth. It was a massive booth, must have cost a fortune, with loads of people on it, and there were loads of people working for it. And it just it was it's quite similar to Roly, except it was in no way really successful. So unfortunately, it just didn't take on, because there was that whole thing about it looking a bit like you're in the Star Wars band, and it didn't look very cool playing it. I suppose you stuck out in sort of the wrong way.
And so, yeah, I'd have worn my cape though. I think if I had one, I'd worn my cape and gone for it. I think you have to own that sort of stuff.
It does, but it's a bit, isn't it a bit like rocking out with an oboe? You know, it just, those
things.
What's
wrong with that?
Well, or bassoon, perhaps.
Yeah, come on. You could rock on a bassoon. I reserve the right. If I could play the bassoon, I'd reserve the right to rock out on it.
You probably could play the bassoon more easily than you could an Eigenharp.
Yeah,
that's the that's the sad truth of it. It was just I've got the website here. Look, the website's here, and it's rather Eigenlabs here, but rather unfortunately, the first thing you see is why buy an Eigenharp, which is a question that's kind of rhetorical, isn't it? I suppose, given what we've been talking about, it's a bit unfair. Yeah.
Beautiful looking things, though, the finish on it, and
it was beautifully made, and it was very expensive, but it was, I would agree, but It was one of those, as Rich Hilton so often says, future doorstop, doorstop of the future, or future doorstop.
Oh, dear.
So, yeah, but, there is. I think we have a Pico somewhere, or we had a Pico. I wonder what happened to that. I haven't seen it for ages. Maybe it got lent, and that was that. I think I might have lent it to Lee. Oh, I can't remember now. Might have gone to Lee Kemp, actually. Happy birthday, Lee, by the way, for a couple of days ago.
Happy birthday, Lee, yeah.
Okay, right. Well, there's that. What else have we got here? We've done history controllers. We've done that one. There are other topics, but... Oh, yeah. Did you see the... Yep, go on.
I was only saying because we had that other, the key step thing as well.
Yes, because we haven't got that in there. The key step, as we know, has become, it's kind of like it's essential kit for modular or laptop performance because it's so small. I mean, it's really, it's perfect. I don't know how many men must have sold it. It must be, I would venture it's the highest selling controller keyboard of all time. And that's a guess. I mean, I don't know that. I would guess that.
I've described it in the past as like almost like the Stratocaster of MIDI controllers, you know, kind of because it's ubiquitous and also very, very versatile. You know, and some people are like, oh, there's no control knobs on there other than the three knobs there. So, you know, as a controller, it kind of lacks that side of things, but makes up for it with its really brilliant sequencer or fun sequencer. And now version 2 firmware has made the sequencer much more useful. Namely, in that the way you'd have to create a sequence in the past was you'd, if you wanted to create like an empty 16 bar, I think we've done this in the past, haven't we, Nick, with something. So you'd have to go into the record mode without it in play mode and just tap in 16 times to create a 16, to create an. Now, you hold down shift and then the numbers which kind of indicate which MIDI channel it is, if you hold down shift and then hit it, that's a way that you can quickly sort of set up how long you want the sequence to be. And that means you can also do that in a performative way as well, that you can kind of have your sequence running and then just shorten it and lengthen it and that sort of thing, which is a pretty big deal if you're a Keystep user. So I think that's pretty cool. I did have real trouble doing the update though. Arturia suggested that you, I mean, if you're doing it on a Mac, that is, trashing all the MIDI in the audio MIDI settings in the MIDI page, but that didn't work for me. What worked for me, just in case anyone else has this problem, was just disconnecting every single thing from the computer other than the keyboard and the monitor, and then it allowed me to update that. So just if anyone has any trouble, then, you know, it's a bit of a pain. But
the thing, I mean, I find that I use the Keystep a lot for demoing stuff, for little desktop things, because the way that the shot is set up there, if you've got like a really big long keyboard and then a module, because you can get a module in at sort of 16:9. So I try and get the keybed in so that the whole thing fits in essentially the ratio of this window. Otherwise, it's like a massive keyboard at the bottom with a tiny module at the top, which looks wrong. Mm-hmm. But the thing I find with the sequencer, and it's really frustrating, is I think what I want is this feel, and you can't get it because you've got to figure out what the divisions need to be to get that kind of little push or little skip. And I just can't, my mind just can't work that way. And I spent ages trying to figure out how to then subdivide it up. What would be really handy to me is if you could start with a 16 step, and then sort of expand it out so that it suddenly then became 32 or 48, but with the same timing, so that the steps, that the intervals just got smaller, so that you could then throw in a little bit of a hey that's off the beat or whatever, because I find that really difficult. If you want to get anything that's not straight and doesn't involve just a swing, it's really difficult to do. And also you have to kind of almost have to put a note in at the beginning, because you never know where one is, because there's no real indicator. So it takes a bit of a knack, in my opinion.
Yeah. Although I do quite love losing the one and just having it, you know, just having it being, you know, totally disorientated from that point of view. What was I going to say, though? A couple of keys have gone dead on my one, though. So if anyone knows how to fix it. Yeah, I opened it up and tried to clean the contacts, but still...
because you throw it about so much.
Around. That might help. What else was I going to say, though? But yeah, I mean, 32 keys makes a big difference compared to the, you know, like a typical smaller keyboard with 25 keys. And, you know, Native Instruments have kind of copied that form a little bit with their M32, their mini keyboard. But Aftertouch as well on a little sub-100 pound
keyboard.
Well, and
let's not forget MIDI CV gate. You know, that's something that's important as well. And that's the reason why you get loads of modular people using it, because it's just, you know.
And also, full-size MIDI ports as well.
It's a classic. I think we could say that, couldn't we?
I think a definite classic. Yeah, even if I've got a couple of dead keys.
Maybe you should drop it again and see if they come back. No, don't do it live.
One of the features that people sometimes forget about, though, is, and this works for in both sequencer and in ARP mode, is that if you hold the shift button, change a setting, like maybe change the time division, so long as you're holding shift down, it doesn't make the change until you release the shift.
Oh, really?
And then if you whack shift down, change it again. Yeah. So you can use that in extremely musical ways.
That's neat. Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah, really neat. Very, very easy to miss that one. So,
I remember Mylar Melodies, Alex, he did a really good kind of like, this is how to use it. And and it's a great video if you check it out. He's had loads of views on it, because for a simple thing, it's actually got a lot of hidden features.
It has. And do you know, one of the things I love so much, and the way that I use it though, is the shift and the MIDI channel change, in that it's just, there's no menu diving, it's so quick. So if you've got a bunch of things like I have at the back here, MIDI, you know, MIDI devices all connected, just being able just to jump to them,
root, and essentially route it somewhere else.
Yeah, super fast. You know, I think that's one of the great things. And of course, that shift, and you can change the gate length with shift, and also the amount of swing as well. And again, because you can do that in this kind of super fast way, it all adds to its performability. And another thing as well is that on the back here, you've got three CV outputs. You've got mod, gate, and pitch.
Yeah.
In the MIDI software, you can change that mod to be fed from the Aftertouch as well. So I think
that's another thing I didn't know. Gosh, I'm learning so much about this already. And I'm trying to think the last time. I haven't used it for a little while, because the last thing I reviewed was the Peak. And then before that, I can't remember what I reviewed before that. I've completely forgotten. It's gone. But there's more stuff coming soon.
Cool.
Okay, well, no, I'm glad we covered that, because it is kind of a big deal. It's always good to see that there's updates going on.
Yeah.
There was this other thing. Was this? Did you see that? Speaking of MIDI interfaces, did you see the Qubit Go, which is just a nice little, really simple MIDI in and out. One MIDI in and out, but with four throughs. So again, you could hook up many different things from the one box, and it's got a one I/O. But inside is a little processor that kind of makes sure that all of those all of those ports are bang on in terms of latency. There's no discernible latency. It's got a little ARM processor in it.
Is that USB just for power, or is it so you can?
No, it's for USB. It's a USB class compliant. It's only $59.
It is class compliant.
And it's only $59 bucks as well. And I'm not sure about this. I don't know if Peter Kern is involved in MeBip, or he's just does their PR for it. I'm not entirely sure.
I think he's involved in the design, I think.
Ah, right, good.
Or, I mean, he's certainly, yeah, I think a lot of the influence of what they do is from him. But, I might be wrong about that, but he's certainly part of the, I strongly associate that product.
Yeah, I thought
with him.
So too. I was going to mention it in the story, but I thought I'm not so sure about that. Maybe I should check. What else have we got?
I've been having lots of fun. Well, just on the MIDI thing. Just I've mentioned this many times. It's just, I think it's one of the best little gadgets on the market. This is the RetroKit RK005, which is a USB host, but it's got tons of really interesting features. The fact it's a really excellent thing for plugging into your OP1 as an example, like a little break, so into the, you know, it hosts the OP1 essentially. So if you would like, if you'd like to have, you know,
MIDI IO
on your OP1, then that's the way to go. But that's only like a fraction of what it can do. This it can play back MIDI files. So if you just plug in a USB card reader
like a thumb
into
drive
it.
Or a...
Yeah, and it'll automatically. So if you have like lots of cards with MIDI files on, and you just plug the MIDI the card in there, and it'll start playing out the MIDI, you know, full 16 channels or whatever.
You could use it as a player. Cool...
Yeah, you can. Yeah. So it's also got a little it's got a little gate output on there, but I think that's configurable as well.
Is it web MIDI configurator?
Yeah.
That's actually reminding me. I've got this guy which was given to me I think last year's Super Booth, and that's
flip it around.
Yeah, I also have that.
Look at that.
It's personalised. Oh, wow, Music Personality of the Year. I didn't realise it said that. I just saw the logo. Guys, yes, I won Music Personality of the Year. I used to be somebody. I didn't get it last year.
2017.
Though. Yeah, right. No. I'm old news now.
Old news. Yeah. But I was mentioning that arcade, that thing again, because I think it's something that sometimes slips under the radar. But if you do have like a doorless kind of situation and you are looking for a problem solver. Again, you know, there's a lot of controller keyboards out there, like the Korg Nano Studio, for instance, that will work over Bluetooth, but it does have a micro USB on there. So just the fact that you can
How does it get power then? Does it need...
You'd then use the... there's a USB port on the front and the back. This one can be like a USB client or power. And then here, this side is the host. But unlike some of the other things, like the Kenton one, this one, if you plug in a hub, you can have it will host loads of devices. I don't know quite how many, but
You could
have
useful.
Yeah. So you could have all your. In fact, I like doing this if I want to unburden, because I got so many USB devices here. If I want to unburden my computer of USB, you know, devices, you can just put it into the hub on here. So that sort of like takes away. So just have
Need to be powered, would it, to get enough juice?
I'd plug it into the computer. It into the computer through the USB client.
Ah, right. So then it just powers everything else.
Yeah. So it gets the power from the client, but also it will just appear as like, you know, just as a single USB. Yeah, sorry, as a sort of your 16 channels, but you can then get at the, I can't remember now if you have to share up just the 16 channels. I'm not sure. I'd have to check it out again. But anyway, sorry, I keep mentioning this thing because I thought that there was going to be tons more USB host stuff to come out and it hasn't.
Well, presumably, presumably writing kind of client drivers or writing class compliant drivers for something that is essentially held. I mean, because it's fixed in time, unless you can update the firmware, there must be other things that cause that.
Yeah, I guess so.
But yeah, anyway, if you want to check out the Mi Blip, it's only, like I say, it's only $59, which is another one of the, maybe that and your and the RetroKits arcade would be an excellent collection both. That could work very well. What else did we have? Oh yeah, I had this on Synth Anatomy. We had you could pimp your Korg MS-20 Mini with these overlays, which I just really like the idea of this stuff. So you can recolor the synth and make hidden, you know, visible, especially on the patch bay, so you can label it up. I don't know what that, and you could just make it look really different. And I'm trying to think what they're $40 is quite expensive for an overlay kit, but I like the idea of this customization. And I know people sort of tend to shy away a bit, particularly collectible. I suppose it depends on how expensive the kit is that you're going to customize, because it could be, you might think it ruins its provenance and. And then you kind of, you know, it's too personal.
Nice, brighter interface, though, could really help if you're using it live, though. Because like I say, like the MS-20, very black surface, if it's, if the lighting is less than ideal.
Very grandmotherly, you know, isn't it? You know. It's very mood grandmother.
Yeah, I was going to say, they turn your MS-20 into a grandmother. Or a great auntie, should we call it.
Let's have a look. Let's have a look at this and see what it's, we make that bit. May as well have a look at the video. Oh, so you've got to take the screws off, and then it's a... so it's a... It's not stickers. Oh, my God. Remove all the knobs. Oh, Jesus.
Oh, big job.
Okay, here we go. Yeah, well, I suppose that makes sense. You'd have to, really, wouldn't you?
Yeah. That's a lot. Oh, that's cool, though.
I like the idea of that. Is it stick-on? So it is, or it's
Looks like he's sticking it on, doesn't it?
Maybe it's magnetic.
Although I'd imagine all the knobs will hold it in place.
That does look cool.
It does.
I don't know. I think the MS-20 got superseded by the... I think they should do more MS-20 desktops, because that was such a great synth. That's one thing I gelled with that really well, because it made the MS-20 make so much more sense to me as a synth, because it was always very limiting, even though, you know, the filters and whatnot made it, but the lack of PWM, which is not a big thing, but things like that and oscillator sync and a few other things besides, and the fact that also the routing was ever so slightly different, so you could actually control the two oscillators independently, which was much harder to do on the original, if not impossible from what I remember. So... yeah, it's a shame that never... that's one thing I wish I'd... because I built that kit and they sent it back, and I wish I'd kept hold of that, because it made a lovely sound and it definitely had a better vibe to it than...
What have you got, though? You've got an old MS-20, though, haven't you?
I've got an original, yeah. I've got an original, yeah. I mean, it's all right, apart from... I don't think I've got anything that will properly control it through voltage. I mean, you know, because it's such a weird... It's S-trig and... Hertz volts. No, Hertz volts, volt... Yeah, Hertz volts, not volt per octave. So it's all... And the trigger is inverted, so the gate, it's all like wrong, basically everything's completely wrong. So you end up kind of like, you stop a note by pressing the button rather than.
One of the bands I saw at the weekend is, Pigs. A band called that, it's often abbreviated to Pigs Times 7. And the singer, he was using an MS-20. And it was a white one. And I was trying to remember, did they do a limited edition all white one? Or I wondered if he'd sort of painted it. Yeah, like an all white. It was all... So at first I was like, what's that?
I think there was. Yeah. I think there
I had a feeling that there might have been.
MS-20 white version. Maybe, let me just have a look.
Yeah.
I think there was a limited edition kit white version.
But you see, that sounded great. I mean, they were really like a really heavy rock band. The sound of the MS-20 when he was, he was doing sort of burbles and splurples and that kind of thing, and it sounded great, alongside all the kind of mashed up guitars. It sort of had it kind of held its own. It's a really ferocious sound you can get off that. A screaming sound.
Oh yeah, and the I think the mini was it the mini or the desktop kit you could switch between the filter types, because there's a type 1 and a type 2 filter from what I remember, and I'm sure there was some sort of boot firmware or boot sequence where you could flip between them, because one was more screamy and one was a bit creamy. that's a possible title.
That's a title, isn't it?
Maybe not. Actually, thinking about it, it could be misconstrued.
It could be misconstrued. Yes.
So far, the titles are Melodically Empty Stomach, which I quite like, Gaz. That was a good one. And I Love Losing the One was another great quote of yours. So that those are possible.
I do.
So it's 2-1 in the titles there. You've got two good ones, and I've got one that's slightly dubious and could be probably not such a good idea. It's a PG title, potentially. my God, it's 5:00. We got it. We got that. Where was that? I think we were close there. Oh, did you see that? Where was it? This band Bastille. That was quite funny. I mean, you can tell when things are getting when things are thin on the ground. You start looking on NME.com for stories.
oh dear.
Yeah, this was Bastille. I think there's a tweet down here somewhere. Where was it? They did a gig in Sweden somewhere, and that basically it just so on a theme park ride, like a massive kind of one of those terrifying drops. So he's got a radio mic and he's singing the lead vocal.
Let's hear it!
Jesus.
Really,
and he's got in-ears as well, so he's obviously got good. They've got good range on his radios.
It's different, different meaning for waiting for the drop, isn't it?
But they got, that's always interesting. It's like, what, which kind of led to one of those? What's the weirdest place you've ever done a gig? I mean, that was more like a playback thing, or he might have gone up there while, you know, the band were playing somewhere. I don't know exactly how that worked, but I just thought that was it might have been a good conversation over. But it is 5 o'clock, so it's kind of like,
yeah, God, yeah, weirdest place to gig. I'd need to think about that one. I've definitely done some weird ones.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of the weird. Weirdest place. One of the weirdest places I went to see a gig was at. It was in Aldborough at the Speed of Sound. I can't remember the name of the. It was like Aldborough Electronic Music Festival. It was one of the first events we covered for ages ago. We drove for 6 or 7 hours to get to Aldborough. It's right over on the east coast of the UK, and it was in. It's on an old US kind of post-war air base. And the control bunker was this massive concrete structure with all of these sort of incredible deflector concrete screens. So, you know, blast resistant, effectively. So then it would just sort of dissipate any kind of blast. And also it could be near the planes. Planes could take off and it would thrust into them and it would be all right. And we did an interview with Modified Toy Orchestra, I think they were called and inside they did a gig inside the bunker, and the bunker was it was in the summer and it was insanely hot, and every room was just a concrete, just a windowless, because it's a bunker, a windowless, airless concrete room with really loud pinging music in it. That was kind of weird. I wasn't where I played, but that was kind of a weird one in terms of a gig.
I mean, I don't know if it's so much weird as kind of impressive, but I played a gig with Charlotte Church in the Pop Dungeon in Edinburgh's Natural History Museum, which was amazing. What a building. They only grant one music license every 5 years. So I felt ever so, you know, privileged to be able to play that gig. But a beautiful big glass. It's one of the most beautiful, certainly the most beautiful place I've ever played. I mean, absolutely dreadful for acoustics.
Yeah, awful sound. Yeah, nine second bass drum reverb. Yeah, I'll bet.
But what a, I mean, gosh, if you do go to Edinburgh, you know, you must visit that place. So it is stunning. But there was just incredible things all around, you know, around us as well. So that was great. But not a good sound. I've done so many weird gigs over the years. I'd have to have a good think about that one. I'm sure there's weird places.
Oh, actually, I've got another one. I've got a story.
Oh, yeah.
I did a gig in Berlin in the 90s with a 10-piece like jazz funk outfit. Sort of quite tight, staccato, rhythmically complicated music, brass section, percussionist, keyboard player, bass player, drummer, you know, all of that kind of thing. And we rocked up and it was the old abandoned central bus depot in Berlin, which is about the size of, I don't know, several enormous aircraft hangars all in one space with loads of, there was a space in the middle, but all surrounding it were all these kind of 1950s, 60s, 70s sort of derelict coaches from, you know, the Cold War era. I think it was in former East Berlin. And we showed up and I thought, oh, this would be challenging. But it got even worse because they basically, the PA company rocked up and just left this pile of PA in the middle of the floor and said, off you go. And I had to build and tune the PA before I could sound check the band in a room where literally it was bass drum. It was just like, it was like a bass drum into a freeze reverb at full bandwidth. I mean, it was just ghastly. The sound was almost impossible. In fact, what happened, we had a power cut, which was actually a bit of a godsend, because then the band played acoustically and it was much better. I didn't know.
Cool.
Yeah, even well, apart from you could only hear drums. I think someone had an acoustic guitar, so it was all right. But yeah, that was the weirdest place I've played to. Most unsuitable.
I remember good. I played at Shunt in London, which was an amazing, it was in the London Underground, And it was kind of like this weird place. I think it was from Victorian era, the early days of the underground. And it was like somewhere where they would store all the underground, all the tube, sort of the carriages and stuff. It was like, it was wonderful. It had like this kind of central sort of, and it was all totally dark. But then you'd have these like kind of tube, like, sort of like little avenues coming off the main sort of the main drag, if you want to call it that, and things would be very dimly lit, and you could just wander through this big network of tunnels. Sadly, that closed down when they we talked about the Shard earlier with that noise box, but when they built the Shard, the skyscraper in London, that was directly over this place, so it kind of closed it down. But that was an amazing place, actually, Shunt. What was quite funny about Shunt was that the way in was just an anonymous door which just opened into London Tower Bridge tube station. It was just an anonymous door, and you just got,
oh, really?
You go through this door and into this big network of tunnels, and it was so cool. But yeah, sadly, gone now. But,
as is so much, property prices and all that. Actually, that was that place that we went to in Berlin with the Seabase? Underground Seabase.
Yeah.
Is it Seabase?
Oh, what a place.
Which was all decked out in kind of like kitsch 1960s, 1970s space internals. But there's a floor below, which was
place.
I didn't get to see that. That was a restricted area, but you got to have a look.
Yeah, restricted area. Yes. Should not really say too much about it, given that it's a hacker space, but it is somewhere. If you are part of that hacker community, I'm sure you'll know about Seabase. But what a brilliant place. After show party there at Superbooth. But spent many an hour there. I think leaving there about 5 or 6 in the morning, and then be back at Superbooth for 10 o'clock. Yeah.
I enjoyed that. I mean, we only went there once because the rest of the time was so knackered, but that was a good fun. I'm looking forward to actually brew the course. Hopefully that'll be good. Well, Gaz, I think we made it. I mean, we've actually surpassed our brief here. So I want to thank everybody for listening. I hope you've enjoyed it.
Yes, definitely.
And I'm just going to give you another view of my antique Synthsite t-shirt. If I find any more of those, I might try, and we might do a giveaway or something. But to see how valuable they all are. That was Sonic Talk number 587. Don't forget, if you want to
587,
want to enter the competition to win Isotope's. I have to do that and then that, don't I? Isotope Neutron 3 Advanced. Don't forget, we're looking for the hashtag 21st Century Mixes, where 21st is 21st, as in 21st, the number representation of that. 21st Century Mixes and the hashtag Neutron 3 to at Sonic State and at Isotope Inc. And we'll pick a winner in the next show. And of course, next week's show is not going to be live. We've got the pre-recorded interview with Imogen Heap, which I thoroughly recommend. She's a great subject, a great interviewer. That's the right way. So thank you, Gaz, for joining us. It's been great fun as ever.
Thank you. Can I just give a couple of cinema tips and and sort of warnings?
Oh yeah, go on then.
I went to see Midsummer. I think you can just catch it.
Oh, is that the horror? Is that the Swedish horror thing?
Folk horror. It's fantastic. It's really good. I mean, it's a bit.
How does it compare to The Wicker Man?
It's very, very favourably. If you like The Wicker Man, you're going to love it. Midsummer, it's brilliant. I loved it. And the soundtrack of that is amazing. But also, I think it was just probably the most beautiful film I've ever seen, actually. In terms of, I think it's all like 4K, really high quality. But gosh, whoa, what a film. But if you like your non-Hollywood style films, then I'd recommend it. It really is. It's a very good film. But the warning is, I just want to warn everybody off the stinking cesspit that is Yesterday, Danny Boyle's latest film.
Oh,
it is
a shame.
Thoroughly, thoroughly disgraceful. Honestly, it's the worst film I've ever seen. I hated every minute of it. It's, oh God, I'm so pleased that I've got a platform where I can vent my spleen about that dreadful thing. Everyone associated with that film should be very ashamed of themselves.
Oh dear.
It truly is absolutely abysmal. Oh God, that was so nearly walked out, you know, just gritted my teeth and tried to get through it just in case.
Can I ask you, was that a common theme from people leaving the cinema, or was it, did it just particularly affect you that way? So
there was hardly anyone there. Hardly anyone there, as is the case with virtually every film I go to see. Is cinemas are so generally empty these days. But there was a group of people who were laughing. Who were laughing at just the most lamest bits. So I guess maybe
I could just picture you standing up and going, "What are you doing? This is dreadful.
What are you doing?"
But yeah. It's a shame because Danny Boyle, as we know, he's like a bit of a creative, you know, he's a creative powerhouse. What happened? I don't know.
You know, because the premise of that film is like this idea
that the Beatles didn't exist, yeah.
Yeah, he has like a bike, gets knocked off his bike by a bus or something. And then, you know, when he comes to, the Beatles don't exist. He's somehow in some, it doesn't explain what that is, some parallel universe or whatever. But the amount of things they could have done with it, it's just so awful. Really, the most vom-inducing, film.
That's your anti-tip.
So, yes. Anti-tip. Please, don't go and see it. Don't go. And if anyone tells you it's good, they're either lying or very, very, I've got no taste. I'm very stupid. I'm sorry. It's a dreadful film. There's no. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right. Well, thanks for letting us know that. I'm sure some people will be pleased to be warned off.
Yeah.
Now, you're probably people are going to go and see it just to see it if it's really that bad. Because that can do that as well, couldn't they? Gaz, thank you very much.
It's not bad. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Look, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off there, but you had your rant set. You were going to say it again, weren't you?
I was just going to say, The Room, you know, which is called the worst film ever, is brilliant to watch. You know, this is like the worst film ever, but with no redeeming facts at all.
Anyway, fair
well, stretching my rant.
Thank you for watching this week. We'll see you not next week. Remember, there's going to be a pre-recorded show next week, but the week after we'll be back. See you later. Bye-bye now.